I'm sure many of you in the audience are afraid that I'm going to try to convert you into being echocardiographers at this late hour tonight. Well, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to try to convert you into being 3D echocardiographers. So I don't know if it's possible to please have the lights down more in order to display the images better. So I've decided to use to answer the specific question, what does 3D echo imaging offer tricuspid valve surgery? I'm going to use a very singular case example, a case that many of you or all of you in the audience may have had a similar case, to illustrate very specific key concepts. These specific key concepts relate to 3D echocardiography's ability to evaluate the leaflets, the chordae, the papillary muscles, the entire tricuspid valve apparatus in its synchronous motion in three dimensions. I'll discuss briefly the ability to measure the vena contracta to estimate regurgitation, the ability to measure effective orifice area for stenosis, and then the application of 3D echo to measure right ventricular volumes and ejection fraction. So this was an 8-year-old male with hypoplastic left heart syndrome who had had a fenestrated fontan. And he was in an ICU on milrinone and diuretic therapy. And he was noted to have significant RV dilation and significant dysfunction, and was noted to have severe tricuspid valve regurgitation. His outside diagnosis had been that he had anterior leaflet prolapse secondary to annular dilation. I'm sure a very similar case to all many of our cases we all take care of. So here's a typical two-dimensional echocardiogram, and you can all appreciate the what really looks like prolapse of the anterior leaflet, and that's what this patient was thought to have. Clearly, we all can see the very severe tricuspid regurgitation. The RV was significantly dilated and dysfunctional qualitatively by this two-dimensional imaging. But in this patient who was in the ICU, we went up to image him with 3D echo, and this is just a live 3D image. Just put the transducer down. And what was most notable here, because we can see in the three-dimensional perspective, was that this leaflet, it's not just prolapsing, it's actually scalloping, perhaps billowing, or perhaps even flail. So we did a 3D volume data set here. And what was most important was that by just changing the imaging plane, you could see the very significant scallop of that leaflet. Now here, because it's a three-dimensional data set, if we rotate the plane and look at the RV from the apex up towards the under leaflet of the valve, you can see a portion of it clearly prolapsing, not prolapsing, I'm sorry, but actually protruding up into the right atrium or almost billowing up there. And then you can see a significant zone of non-coaptation between this anterior and the septal leaflet. We started to get the impression that the septal leaflet was severely tethered. So here we can see the cross-sectional image of the valve from below, and you can see a very significant zone of non-coaptation between the anterior and the septal leaflet. When we went to the 3D color format, we could see there was severe tricuspid valve regurgitation, and the format to the right will rotate it around. And in three dimensions, you can see it was a very low large jet of regurgitation. Now, the importance of this slide is that in three dimensions, you can truly measure the tricuspid valve annular size. So there are two or a longitudinal simultaneous cut planes, a four-chamber and a two-chamber view. And then you can see the blue cross-sectional plane that we can put precisely in the region of the annulus, and we get an on-foss cross-sectional view of the annulus, which we can then trace and evaluate the annulus as it truly exists in three dimensions. Now, we can also do that for the vena contracta. The vena contracta, a direct measurement of the area of regurgitation. And this was based on work done and presented in the American Society of Echocardiography. And here's just an R patient from their transthoracic echocardiographic view. You could get a three-dimensional format of the regurgitation. And again, in longitudinal segmented two-dimensional views, you could precisely place your cut plane in the area of the vena contracta, and you could annulate so you're directly in alignment with the regurgitation. And again, you can planimeterize that area specifically as it truly exists. Now, Brian Soriano in our laboratory several years ago published a position paper in which we measured RV volumes by 3D echo and compared those to MRI. And on the base of this paper, we've been able to use and measure RV volumes, which we did in our patient. And this is using the semi-automated detection algorithm. We measured the RV volume at 160 mLs per meter squared with an ejection fraction of 47%. Well, based on these two-dimensional images, we had the clear-cut and three-dimensional images. We had the impression, and I showed these to Dr. Del Nido, that the leaflet was not just prolapsing because of RV dilation, but it was flail. It seemed to be moving freely back and forth. So the decision was to go to the operating room. And you can see in this two-dimensional image the motion of the anterior leaflet of the mitral valve. But we had in the concept of our mind that this wasn't just typical prolapse, but this was perhaps a flail leaflet. We confirmed the severe tricuspid valve regurgitation. And then we went to 3D imaging by transesophageal epicardial echo in the operating room itself. And these are segmented images that we were able to make in the operating room. And I could say, hey, Pedro, take a look at this image. And he's used to me doing that very often. But in this image, what you're doing is you're looking down onto the tricuspid valve from the right atrium. And you can see the significantly proximal tethered septal leaflet right here. And you can see the very extensive zone of non-coaptation. Now, this image actually surprised me when we created it, because I've never quite seen it. But this is the severe, this is like a longitudinal view of the tricuspid valve. And here is the severe flail portion of the anterior leaflet. But most importantly, we could see the zone of non-coaptation and the very tethered septal leaflet. But the other thing we could see is the longitudinal extent of the papillary muscles to the chordae tendinae to the undersurface of the valve. And we could see chordae anterolaterally, but none, posteriorlaterally, but non anteriorly onto the undersurface of the valve there. In two-dimensional imaging, because you always have at any point in time a singular cut plane, it's virtually impossible to see the papillary muscles, the chordae, and the undersurface of the valve leaflets at the same time. And you can't really see the synchronous motion of that. But in a three-dimensional format, where you actually have depth, you have the ability to see all those parameters simultaneously. I think the importance in our patient here was that there was the possibility, knowing that there were lack of chordal attachments to the leaflet, and knowing that you had a severe flail component of the leaflet, that you could repair this valve rather than replace it. And so we could demonstrate in the operating room to Dr. Del Nido that there were absence of both primary and secondary cords to that anterior leaflet. There was a lack of chordae to the edge of the leaflet and even to the body of the leaflet. So the beauty is we could take our cut plane right below the leaflet, right up to it, and clearly show no chordal attachments up to this anterior portion of the leaflet. Now, after repair, in which Dr. Del Nido was able to close the commissure between the anterior septal leaflet, put in a ring, and then attach an artificial cord to the anterior leaflet, as you can see, there was much improved leaflet coaptation with a good coaptation height. There was the absence of significant tricuspid regurgitation with good tricuspid inflow. And then in the operating room, in this longitudinal view, we could see the chordal attachment, this artificial gourd going from the papillary muscle up to the chordae tendon A. Importantly, we could turn it on its side and segment closer in, and we saw the absence of the severe flail anterior leaflet with a very good length of coaptation. Here's the annular ring. And again, because of this being 3D echo, we could now look down onto the annulus from the right atrium. We could see the U-shaped configuration of this annular ring and the absence of any perivalvar leak. Now, importantly, that was in the operating room. So what did it look like before discharge? Did it still hold true? Now, of course, all of you know your transthoracic imaging isn't that good in the postoperative patient. But we clearly could see the absence of the flail anterior leaflet. There was no longer any significant tricuspid valve regurgitation. And importantly, when we looked at these images from the RV apex, we could see the chordal attachment was directly attached up to the undersurface of the tricuspid valve. By three-dimensional color flow imaging, there was absence of tricuspid regurgitation and a very good inflow jet. But again, similar to the other measurements we had made, we could now truly measure the effect of orifice area. As you all know, especially for the right side, the gradient may not give a true indication of the severity of the stenosis. So what you really would like to do, and what we should be doing as a pediatric community, is talking about effective orifice area. So again, because you've got the entire data set in the volumetric data set here, you can segment out simultaneous two-dimensional views. So this is the long axis four-chamber view, long axis two-chamber view, and you can put your cut plane in blue directly across the effective orifice area, look at it directly on FOSS, trace it, and measure the effective orifice area as it truly exists. And importantly, without having to go to another procedure like an MRI, you can imagine it would be difficult to sometimes get an MRI in an immediate postoperative patient. We could measure his ventricular volumes by 3D echo. And note, there was a marked reduction in the RV volume, nearly 35%. The ejection fraction had gone down, which we clearly attributed to the sudden release or take away of the low resistance tricuspid regurgitation, making the ejection fraction go down. Subsequent imaging will hopefully show that it goes back up again. So the most important thing I wanted to share with you, using a key example, is that you can use 3D echo to truly evaluate the tricuspid valve anatomy, the function, and the RV volumes and ejection fraction. Thank you very much.
Please help us improve the content by providing us with some feedback.